Shalom, and welcome to Via Havta Yisrael, a Hebrew phrase which means, you shall love Israel. We hope you'll stay with us for the next 30 minutes as our teacher, Dr. Baruch, shares his expository teaching from the Bible. Dr. Baruch is the senior lecturer at the Zera Avraham Institute based in Israel. Although all courses are taught in Hebrew at the Institute, Dr. Baruch is pleased to share this weekly address in English. To find out more about our work in Israel, please visit us on the web at loveisrael.org. That's one word, loveisrael.org. Now, here's Baruch with today's lesson.
Are you hearing godly teaching? What I mean by that is simply, are you hearing the truth of God? The truth that is going to prepare you for the last days. Because if you are setting under false teaching, the outcome of that is going to be disastrous. And perhaps not just in this world, but forever and ever. Well, we have seen that Messiah is speaking about the leaders in his day. And we see that he's not pleased with them. In fact, he has spoken in a very derogatory manner concerning them. And the reason why is simply this, because they are leading the people to destruction. We're going to see that this passage of Scripture is going to show a transition, not just from the times of Yeshua, but it's laying the foundation for what we're going to begin next week when we look at Matthew chapter 24, that teaching that Messiah gave on the Mount of Olives concerning the last days. That chapter is vital for us to have a proper understanding of what will be. And in order to have that proper understanding, we need to know proper teaching, godly truth. Take out your Bible and look with me to the book of Matthew and chapter 23. The book of Matthew, chapter 23. And as I said to you, he has been speaking. We saw this 2 weeks ago, 1 week ago, and now today. He is going to continue even in harsher terms speaking about the leaders. Why is he so against them? Because they are against the truth of God. Let's begin. Verse 27, Matthew chapter 23 and verse 27. He begins as he has several other times when he says, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees." We've learned about the significance of this word, woe. It is a call to change. What it means is this. If you do not change, if you continue in the direction that you're going, then how awful it's going to be. And if I could say one word to society today, it would be that same word, woe. Why? Because unless individuals make a change, a serious change, to embrace the truth of God. And where do you find the truth of God? Right here in the Scripture, in the Holy Bible. Not in some other religious writings, not in some other faith that is not faith at all. It's only when we embrace the truth of God can we make a godly change that is pleasing to Him. So again, he warns, he speaks against this leadership. And he says, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees." And notice again, he calls them hypocrites. Why is he displeased? Well, here he says, "Because you are likened to tombs having been whitewashed." Now, whitewashed tombs, we're going to see, they look good to the eye. But the primary characteristic of a tomb is not on the outside, but inside. And that whitewashing, it looks good to the human eye, but it has absolutely no effect on that which is inside. And this is why he continues and he says, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, because you are like tombs having been whitewashed, who outwardly appear beautiful." But, and this is such a significant conjunction. He's showing a contrast. But, he says, on the inside, you are full of dead bones and all types of impurity. Now, this word impurity, it's the same word that we spoke of last week for that which is not clean. And I hope you remember what we learned about it. That term, not clean, impure, what does it do? It rejects, it causes one to be rejected by God. Meaning this, God's promises, God's blessings, His power, His presence, His provision, all these things when we are in the state of being unclean spiritually, those things are not going to be able to be received. When we're unclean, we are rejecting God's influence in our life. And this is one of the primary things he's saying about this type of leadership. If you follow their teaching of the scribes and the Pharisees and people today who are not speaking the word of God, then you are going to find yourself being rejected by God, not having access to his presence and his power in your life. So he says, woe to these individuals, because on the inside, they are full of dead bones and all impurity. Verse 28. So that also you on the outside appear to men righteous. Now hear what he's saying and what he's not saying. He's saying, also you, comparing them to tombs, whitewashed tombs, you on the outside, you appear to men, but the implication is not to God. God, he knows all things. And he says, you appear to men to be righteous. That's how others see you. But in reality, notice what he says, but on the inside, you are full of hypocrisy and pay attention to this last word, lawlessness. Now, as I mentioned, we are moving in a transition that's going to lead us to a teaching on the end times. And when he says this term, lawlessness, now some Bibles may translate it differently, but it's literally the word nomos, which is the Greek word for Torah or law. And it has a one-letter prefix, the Greek letter alpha, which is a negation. So it speaks about a characteristic, a behavior, a thought process, which is against the law. Now, remember the word he used. A few minutes ago, he says, you appear to men to be righteous, but they're not. They have that characteristic of lawlessness. And what I want to share with you is this. We find that Messiah himself, also the Apostle Paul, they use that same term, lawlessness, for speaking about the Antichrist. And when we, and hear this carefully, when we subject ourselves to false teaching, when we do not study to show ourselves approved, when we are under the influence of that which is not true from God's vantage point, that's in conflict with scriptural authority, we are going to be exemplifying the behavior of the Antichrist, and we will be deceived by him. Meaning we will not be servants of the real Messiah, but of the false Messiah. Verse 29. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, because you build up, and hear this carefully, they build up the tombs of the prophets. Now, in this next few verses, we're going to see how previously, and nothing has really changed, how these leaders were against the prophets of God. Now, I need to pause for a moment and just share with you that there is today a modern movement of prophets and such. And I oftentimes get letters, where do I stand in regard to that? Against it. Why? Their character, their lifestyle, what they say about the Bible, they get it wrong. These are false prophets. And notice, if we're going to be individuals that are going to be found faithful, live in a godly testimony, be people that he's well pleased with, the emphasis is on prophecy. And when I say prophets, I'm speaking about the prophets of the scripture. Men like Zechariah, Isaiah, Ezekiel, Jeremiah, and others that we read about that have books in the Bible. These are the true prophets. And what did these individuals do? Well, notice what he says. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, you hypocrites, because you build up the tombs of the prophets and you decorate the monuments of the righteous ones. Now, do you see something? We see a connection between prophets and the term righteousness. Why is that? It is only when we learn, understand, and apply prophetic truth to our life, it's that prophetic truth that will produce righteousness. And when we are hearing false prophets and realize, as we approach the last days, there are going to be many, an increase. This is what we're going to learn in several weeks. There's going to be an increase of false prophets. And that's what we're seeing today. Individuals say, well, a prophet doesn't have to be right all the time. If he's a biblical one, he is. And if he's not, under Old Testament law, he should be stoned. So these are the ones that build up the tombs of the prophets, and they decorate the monuments of the righteous ones. And they say, if we were in the days of our fathers, we would have not been their partners in the blood of the prophets. Now, they acknowledge something, that their forefathers killed the prophets. They did not want to hear God's revelation. They did not want truth that would produce righteousness in their life. And these Pharisees and scribes and leaders in that time during the days of Messiah, 2,000 years ago, they said, well, we're not like our forefathers that did that. But notice what Messiah said concerning that. Look now to verse 31. He says, so that you yourselves testify that you are sons of murderers, the murderers of the prophets. And he goes on, he says in verse 33, and you are full of that same measure of your fathers, meaning this. If you measure this age, the age of these individuals, the scribes and the Pharisees, if you measure them to discern their content, what they're like, he says, you are resembling them exactly. There's no difference, different time, but not a different mentality. So that you witness yourselves that you are sons of the murderers of the prophets, verse 32, and you are full of that same measure of your fathers. And he goes on, verse 33, what does he call them? He says, serpents and offspring of vipers. How will you flee the judgment of hell? Now, notice, he speaks about judgment and hell. And I want to say something. If you are attending a local congregation, or you are getting spiritually fed from someone who never ever speaks about God as judge, never speaks about hell, this is a false teacher. because he has not given you the whole counsel of God's word. The whole concept of a literal hell is under attack today, and it has been for quite some time. You'll find that some of the most popular Bible teachers, and I use that term very loosely, they never want to talk about hell. And certainly not a hell that is related to fire and torment. They'll say, well, it's just a spiritual experience that you're burning for God. No, your souls are literally on fire. That's what the scripture repeats over and over in the word of God. Secondly, he says, look now to verse 34. On account of this, he's going to do something. I will send unto you prophets, also wise ones and scribes. Now these are true prophets, true sages, those who have God's wisdom, and those who are actually scribes, meaning they understand the written word. And what's going to happen? He says, and from them you will kill and you will crucify, and from these you will flog in the synagogues, your synagogues, and you will persecute them from city to city. Now, Messiah, earlier on, several months ago, we saw that in the last days, prior to the establishment of the kingdom of God, prior to Messiah's return, there is going to be those that go throughout the city of Israel, and they will not complete going to all the cities before the Son of Man comes. And these individuals, although they're going to be speaking truth, they're going to be persecuted. What does it say here? They're going to be murdered, they're going to be crucified, and they're going to be, and don't make a mistake about this, flogged, meaning a very, very barbaric punishment. All these things, he says, they are going to do from one place to another, one city to another. Now look at verse 35. So that the blood, the righteous blood of the ones who were poured out shall come upon you. Now this is an idiom for judgment. He's simply saying, upon you shall come all the righteous blood that has been shed upon the earth, from the blood of righteous Abel, that first one who was murdered, unto the blood of Zechariah, the son of Barachiah. Now, there's a dispute who this is. Is it the prophet or is it someone else? Not important. What is important? He was a righteous man. He spoke and he served God faithfully. And what happened to him? He was killed. In the same way that Abel brought a God-pleasing sacrifice, he did the right thing. And what happened? He was put to death. What he's telling us is this: there's coming a time, and remember, all of this is leading up to the last days. This study is laying the foundation for what he's going to say concerning the end times in the next chapter. And what is going to happen, what we can expect, is that there will be great persecution, suffering, death for those who speak and live righteously. What else? Also, he says in verse 35 at the end, this Zechariah, who was murdered between, and if your Bible says temple, it's incorrect. It's the word naos. Naos is the sanctuary, speaking about that holy place. So he was murdered between the sanctuary and the altar. That's what the word of God literally says. Verse 36. Truly I say to you, all these things will come upon this generation. And what he's referring to here is that persecution of believers that are going to lead up to Israel being no more. Israel going into exile. What exile? The exile that began 70 and 70 AD. with the destruction of that second temple by Rome. So we're speaking about the Roman exile, the longest and the most bitter of all the exiles. He says that's going to happen to that generation. And you know what? It did. Because 40 years after his death, burial, and resurrection, and the fact that the people did not receive him, their unrighteousness grew, the false teachings became prominent, and what happened? 40 years after his resurrection, we know that the holy city of Jerusalem, the temple, they were burnt and destroyed, and the people went into exile. But a little over 70 years ago, Israel was reborn. Israel as a nation was reestablished. And that has great prophetic significance. Well, let's move on. Notice what he says in verse 37. This final passage of chapter 23, as I said, it too lays the foundation for the last days. We read verse 37, Jerusalem, Jerusalem. Now, Messiah is saying this with great heaviness, weeping over the spiritual condition of the Jewish people. And he says, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the ones who has killed the prophets and stoned the ones sent to her, how often I desire to gather your children up in the manner such as a hen, presumably a mother hen, would gather up her chicks under the wings. But, and here's the problem, and you were not willing. Now this says something about understanding the sovereignty of God. We, of course, believe in the divinity of Messiah. And therefore, Messiah is saying, as the servant of God, the only begotten Son of God, he says, God wanted to gather you up. This was his will, but it didn't happen. Why? Because the people were unwilling. This shows how we have free will and we can rebel against God. That means sin is possible. And this is what brought about the exile. This is what brought about such pain and suffering and destruction. When he says, how often I wanted to gather up your children as a hen gathers up her chicks, her young. But he says, you were not willing. Verse 38. Behold, your houses will be left desolate. Now, again, it's only when you are studying in the original language that you can get a fuller appreciation for what he's saying here. Because if you're a good Bible student, you pay attention to every word and the grammatical condition of every word. It takes time, it takes effort, but the dividends are large and great. And when he says, your homes will be left desolate. The word for desolate is the same word that the term for a wilderness or a desert is derived from. Now, we know something. We know that God brought the people into the desert, into that wilderness experience for 40 years. Why? To teach them that they needed to be dependent upon him, to trust him. And what the scripture is saying is all of this is happening. It's in the future. It will happen. This destruction of the temple, the city of Jerusalem, the people going into the longest, the most bitter exile, nearly 2,000 years of no nation of Israel. It's all happening for one reason: to teach the people dependence upon God, to trust him. So he says, behold, your houses I will leave to you desolate, for I say to you, you will not see me from now until you shall say, And then he quotes, as so frequently he does, from the scriptures. He quotes from Psalm 118. Now that Psalm 118 is a very important one. We recite it with a group of others known as the Hallel on holidays, also on the beginning of every new month. It has great significance. In fact, according to Jewish tradition, we say it standing up to testify. And Messiah says something, I will not come again, meaning you won't see me until you proclaim. What does he say? Until you shall say, blessed is the one, and this is messianic. Blessed is the one who comes in the name. Name is synonymous with character. In the name of the Lord. What we know is this. The kingdom of God, not speaking about our blessed hope, the rapture, but Messiah's second coming, a different event. That second coming to bring judgment upon the enemies of God, deliver the Jewish people, bringing them to salvation, because that is a requirement for that remnant, not all, but that remnant to be brought to faith, the same faith in that same gospel, to be brought to faith before Messiah will establish the kingdom of God. When we look at the scripture, we see that Israel is at the heart of God's will. And until Israel gets right with God, the kingdom of God won't be established. And that's why Satan is so concerned about Israel. And that's why he will try in the last days to bring them to believe in him. He will not be successful. And in his anger, he is going to do what? Bring the greatest time of suffering, the most barbaric time of tribulation upon the Jewish people ever, even worse than the Holocaust. And it's known based upon what is said in Jeremiah chapter 30 and verse 7, it's going to be a time of trouble for Jacob. All of this is prophetic truth so that we can understand the purposes of God, the plans of God, how God is going to work, especially how he's going to work in the last days. And that's why I'm very excited about chapter 24 and the studies that we will do for the next 4 to 6 weeks about the last days. Invite a friend. Until then, shalom from Israel.
Well, we hope you will benefit from today's message and share it with others. Please plan to join us each week at this time and on this channel for our broadcast of loveisrael.org. Again, to find out more about us, please visit our website, loveisrael.org. There you will find articles and numerous other lectures by Baruch. These teachings are in video form. You may download them or watch them in streaming video. Until next week, may the Lord bless you in our Messiah Yeshua, that is, Jesus, as you walk with him. Shalom from Israel.